welcome you to a very special day. We're calling it Vision Sunday, where we're charting the course for where God is leading us as a church. And there are very few things that I get more excited about than preaching on our future vision as a church. And if you're a guest with us, I want to say welcome. You picked a great day to be here because you're going to get to see under the hood, and you're going to get to know why you are so important to us as a church. And I'd like to welcome those of you who are joining us online, all of you at our Sunnyvale and our South San Jose campus. Can we put it together for everybody joining us? Well, as we start talking about vision today and we talk about discovering our purpose, I thought it'd be fun to play a little game together. And it's a game I like to call Name That Tool. And this is my toolbox here. In fact, this toolbox is kind of lonely because I don't really do a whole lot of work around the house. Stacy puts together honey-do lists, and I consider it my list to delegate to other people that are willing to help. So if you do have handyman skills, you're always invited over our house. We'll feed you a meal. I'll preach, you fix things, and it'll be a good combo. But one time I had recently a guy over our house, and he started telling me about the different tools I have and what their purpose is. So I thought it'd be fun to look at some of these tools. We'll start with an easy one. I'll pull the tool out. All of you, all of our campuses, just shout it out. If you're at a coffee shop watching online, you might not want to do that. But for all of us, the rest of us, let's just shout out the tool and what its purpose is. Okay, you guys ready for the game?
Yeah.
All right, let's start with an easy one. What is this thing right here called?
Hammer.
Oh my goodness. At North San Jose, everybody's awake today. And it's probably because they got an extra hour of sleep. But this hammer here, what do you use a hammer for? Hammer things. That's right. Hammer fingers, hammer nails. Hammer holes in the wall, that's what it does for me. So this is a hammer, that was good. All right, let's try another one. What is this thing right here called?
Tape measure.
Tape measure, yes. And what do you use a tape measure for? To measure things. Wow, this is awesome. You guys are amazing. All right, what's this one right here called?
A saw.
What do you use that for? Somebody just said keep your spouse and kids online in line, right? That'll get you in prison. This is for sawing wood, yes. Okay, so a saw, let's do one more. What's this? Oh, I'm not sure how that got in there. Sometimes my kids get my toolbox. And then what's this?
Staple.
Oh, there's no staples in it, but what do you do with a stapler? Staple, okay, yes, that was a fun game. Can we give it up for the toolbox? You know, every tool in here has a purpose, right? And it's not when it sits in the bag that it discovers its purpose. It's when it comes out and it's in the master's, or somebody who's more masterful than me, when it's in the master's hands, the tool discovers its purpose. You know, you were created by God for a purpose. And there are certain parts of your personality and your wiring and your passion that God gave to you for a very specific purpose to fulfill here on earth. I love the way the Bible communicates in Acts chapter 13, verse 36 about King David. King David, who was one of the great kings of the nation of Israel, one of the most central figures to all of the Bible, aside from Jesus, lived out his purpose. It says, "For when David had served God's purpose in his own generation, he fell asleep, he was buried with his ancestors, and his body decayed." How would you love for that to be said about you? That you served God's purpose in your generation. That you fulfilled what it was that God had for your life in this day and age. And see, what happens is oftentimes there are so many people that they live their lives like tools in a toolbox that never come out. They never discover the fullness of the purpose that God has for their lives. And so today I want to talk to you about how do you step into your purpose? And how do we collectively, together as a church, fulfill the purpose he's given to us? Because churches, just like people, have purposes. And many times churches circle. Without mission, without significance, without what God has asked them to do becoming a reality. So we're going to ask, how do we collectively and how do we individually step into the purpose that God has for us? And I'd like to invite you at all of our campuses, if you have a Bible, to turn to John chapter 6. We're going to walk through an incredible story from the Bible. It's one of my favorite stories in the New Testament. It's from the life of Jesus. Now, you have to understand, these accounts in the New Testament, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they are eyewitness accounts. So they're not fables. They're stories that actually happened when Jesus was here on planet Earth. And in John chapter 6, we see this incredible story where Jesus is spending time with a large group of people. We know from the context that there's over 5,000 men, which means that there are probably about 10,000 people who were following Jesus. And it's getting towards the end of the day, And they're all hungry. There's not enough food to go around for all these people. Now, if you have kids or maybe you've been around for some time, you know, at the end of the day, when you're really hungry and you can't get the food, what happens? You get hangry, right? We call it hangry in our house. It's when you combo hungry and angry together. And then when you eat, everybody's better again. So here are 10,000 people that are hangry with Jesus. They're hanging with Jesus and they're hangry. And they're following him around. And there's a predicament that they find themselves in. And the predicament is that there's no food for all these people. They've been following Jesus all day long, but there's no food for them to eat. And Jesus looks up and he sees this great crowd. In John chapter 6, verse 5, it says, when he looks up, he saw the great crowd coming towards him. And he said to Philip, one of his disciples, where shall we buy enough bread for all of these people to eat? That's a great question. Now, in their day and age, they didn't have Five Guys or Ike sandwiches or 1,000 Chipotles on every corner. They didn't have a solution to the problem. So Jesus presents Philip with a problem. We have 10,000 people and we don't have enough food. How are we going to find enough food to feed 10,000 people? And I love the way that John so carefully inserts this detail into the story. It says, Jesus, he only asked him this to test him. For he, in verse 6, already had in mind what he was going to do. I'm kind of like a little bit frustrated when I read a detail like this, because I often feel like Philip, where God will put in my heart something or ask a question that he already knows the answer to. And I'm like, you already know the answer to this question, so why are you asking me the question? It was bothering me this week when I was reading the Bible. Sometimes the Bible bothers me when I read details, and I'm thinking, why in the world would Jesus ask Philip this question when he already has in mind the solution to the problem? There's this massive problem. There are all these people. They're all hungry. They're crying. They're frustrated. They're angry. We don't want fistfights to break out like at a Donald Trump rally. We don't want that to happen. We want some peace here. And Jesus is asking the question, how are we going to feed all of these people, Philip? And he already knows what he's going to do. See, there's something important for us to recognize when you look at your life and you look at this story. Sometimes we get ourselves into problems, problems where we're in over our heads. Our capacity, what we have, is not enough for what we need. There's a gap. There's a problem. There's a problem in our marriage, and we don't have the resources to solve the problems in our marriage. There's a problem at work, and you're frustrated with a coworker, and you don't know how to work through it. There's a problem in your finances. And what can happen very easily is when you find yourself in a problem, you can start to think that the problem is the point. And you can start to work through to try to find the solution to your problem. But Jesus asked Philip this question about the problem because the problem wasn't the point. The process was the point. In fact, if Jesus would ask Philip the question, how do we solve this problem before he provides the solution? Jesus provides a solution to the problem. Philip would now interpret the entire situation through a different lens. So you've been spending all your time trying to figure out your problem when Jesus is trying to get you to see that the problem is not the point. The process is the point. In fact, he has you in some problems right now that you don't have a solution to. And you're so frustrated and so exhausted and so angry because you're trying to solve it. And you're here today because he wants you to realize that actually there's something that he's doing in you that is far greater than what he's trying to do through you to solve the problem that you're in right now. So he asks him, how are we going to solve the problem? Now, Philip looks back at Jesus and he makes a very important point. Philip answers him 8 months. I wonder what his tone of voice was like when he responded. Was it like 8 months or 8 months of wages would not buy enough food for all of these people to have a single bite? Not like a computer bite, like a bite of food. Okay. Now we got a lot of nerds in our church, but he's talking about food here. It wouldn't be enough for all of these people to have a single bite of food. See, now at this point, Philip is merely trying to solve the problem through a natural solution. He's trying to do the math in his head. Okay, well, if we go to this falafel place over here and we go to this restaurant and we get, we can't, eight, 8 months is, it's not even enough to get one bite for all these people. In his mind, the solution is going to have to be a natural solution. But you know what's important to see? Is that there is a big difference in your life and my life between misbehaving your way into a problem versus obeying your way into a predicament. Let me say it like this. Whenever Stacy and I got married almost 14 years ago, I promised her that I would become more of a man. I gave her my word. But what she didn't know is what that word meant, because in the first 3 years of marriage, I put on 30 pounds and became more of a man. You know what I'm saying? And I wanted God to heal me and provide a solution so I could lose the weight. Like, I go to sleep one night. Anybody, you know what I'm saying? Like, go to sleep one night, I wake up, I'm 30 pounds lighter. I need a miracle, Jesus. But what God showed me was that my solution to my problem was not a miracle. It was he would give me the wisdom and strength to behave my way back. And really what I needed was to start going to Weight Watchers and stop eating so many donuts and stop sitting on the couch with a full box of pizza. That's what he showed me. See, sometimes when you misbehave your way into a problem, you want a miraculous solution. And then what happens for me, I don't know if it happens for you, but sometimes I get these mixed up, because then I find myself in a predicament that I've obeyed my way into, where I simply have done what Jesus asked me to do. And then when I get into that situation, I'm still trying to figure out naturally how I could solve the problem in my strength. It's kind of like, you know, a lot of people, if you've been around for the last couple of months, know that God provided a building for our Sunnyvale campus in a very miraculous way. Unbelievable. And I said to our staff when I went on sabbatical last summer, I said, don't call me when I'm gone, okay? Unless you have a building. Well, about 3 weeks in, they called me and said, God's opened up a door for us to have a building. And it was amazing, all the miracles that happened, from our people giving sacrificially and all that came together, you know, reports and stuff with the church that sold us the building and documents and contracts that shouldn't have come together but did because God's hand was in it. But then when we signed on it, we still have a mortgage that we have to pay. And I saw recently the monthly bill, which we knew in advance that it would be this, but it hit me. It was like, now we have $50,000 more a month in building payments to a mortgage. It just got real, y'all, when I saw that. And it's so easy for me in my natural human response to try to figure out if I can solve this problem that's in front of me. But Jesus is trying to get Philip to see something that he's been trying to get me to see, is that he's the one actually who's way bigger than a $50,000 mortgage. He's the one that spoke the skies into existence. And when there's a gap between what we have and what we need, how we see it really matters. So the first point, if you're going to step into your purpose for what God has for your life, is you have to see the gap. Your predicament that you're in is opportunity. You have to understand that when there is a gap between what you have and what you need, and that gap exists because you obeyed Jesus, with human strength, you cannot fill that gap. You will never in your power fill that zone, but that zone becomes the opportunity zone for the miraculous power of God to intervene on your behalf. It's kind of like, how many guys watched the game this week, all of our campuses, the World Series Game 7? Now, I just a moment of confession here. Baseball's a good sport, but it's a great sport to fall asleep to, if you know what I'm saying. Like, during the regular season, I mean, I love going to games with people and hanging out because you can have a conversation. I love basketball. It's way better in terms of my ADD mind because something's always going with basketball. Baseball, it's like, and there was a pitch. And there was a pitch. But at the end of the game 7, in the bottom of the 10th inning, I'm sitting there and I had this thought. I'm so glad I'm not the one on the pitching mound right now. Anybody else think that? I'm like, I am so glad that somebody who gets paid $15 million or $20 million a year to throw 8 pitches, that he's the one throwing this pitch right now. Because I can't even get it over, I can't get it over the plate, let alone throw it in the strike zone. But you know, what happened is the general manager in that moment had confidence In the guy's ability to throw it over the plate, because of his past faithfulness, he had confidence in the future that he could put this guy out there and throw the strike perfect, pitch perfect. And you know, the same is true for us, that sometimes in our lives, we get ourselves into predicaments and we're trying so hard to figure it out in our strength, but I'm so glad that there's somebody that's on the mound and it's not me. That there's somebody who's faithful, who can provide, and it's his past faithfulness that gives me confidence in the future. So if in our lives, we always think that we're the one that has to throw the pitch perfectly, we'll never allow ourselves to get into predicaments where God has to intervene on our behalf. You don't know greatness in spring training. You know greatness at the bottom of the 10th inning in game 7 of the World Series. So some of us never test God. We never allow him to get us into some situations where he has to come through. So we live spring training Christian lives instead of letting God prove that he's able to do it. That he who spoke the world into existence can provide the solution to your predicament when you find yourself there. So you have to see the zone between what you have and what you need is the opportunity zone for God to do the miraculous. So he's been asking you, how are we going to do it? How are we going to solve the problem? And he's asking you so you can see it, so that you can interpret it differently. I remember when we first came to the Bay Area, I went to the Santa Clara Art and Wine Festival. This is before we had a church. It's before we had people. This is before we had money. It's before we had two buildings and a third campus. Before any of that. And I'm walking around and there's like 60,000 people at this event. And I felt like the Holy Spirit was asking me, how are all these people going to be reached? I'm like, I don't know. That's your job. I thought our agreement was that's your role. But see, when he asks you the question, he doesn't ask you the question so you solve the problem. He asks you the question so that you can see the opportunity to realize he's the one that's going to solve the problem. So Jesus then says, you know, okay, how's it going to be solved? And Philip's like, I don't know. 8 months is not enough. So then there's another disciple who like just kind of speaks up. I love these guys because they always talk, you know, and I can relate to saying things that you shouldn't say. So one guy just speaks up. And he's like, hey, Simon Peter's brother Andrew spoke up. He said, hey, here's a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. Can you solve the problem now? But how far can it go among so many people? How can this solve the problem? And the question is, it depends. It depends on whose hands the fish and the loaves are in. Because if the fish and loaves are in the boy's hand, then obviously it's not going to solve the problem. But if you put them in the right hands, there's limitless potential with a couple of fish and a couple of loaves. So Jesus then says, okay, have everybody sit down. And there was plenty of grass in that area, so there's like thousands of people, and there was about 5,000 men. And Jesus, I love this, it says, then Jesus took the loaves. Y'all, this is like middle school cafeteria. And mom sends 12-year-old boy to the event with Jesus with a lunch. He's got a Superman pail in hand. And I'm imagining this conversation when he goes home that night. Where's your lunch? Jesus took it. That's like the principal just getting hungry and trying to walk into the cafeteria and taking some middle school student's lunch. But the point I want us to see from the story is that in order to step into your purpose, you have to give up control. And sometimes it feels like God is taking from us when he asks us to give up control in our lives. Some of us never see the miraculous that God can do in our lives because we never give up control. So every scenario in our lives is dependent upon our power to solve the problem. But this little boy takes this few fish and loaves of bread and he gives up control and he places them into the hands of Jesus. You know, there have been times in my life where I felt like God was saying to me, I want you to go all in. In fact, there have been 2 specific times since Stacy and I have been married that we felt like God was telling us to empty out our bank account. Now, the first few years of marriage, that didn't really matter because we didn't have any money at all. But more recently, one time was when we adopted our son, Sammy, from Ethiopia, and we felt like God was telling us to do it. We obeyed our way into a predicament, and our checking account and savings account went all the way down. The second time was when we moved into the North San Jose building, and we were trusting God to provide the resources for a facility, and we cleared our bank account to provide the resources. And sometimes in our lives, it feels like we have nothing left to give. But the reality is, it's a matter of how you frame it, because it's not that you have nothing left to give, it's that you have everything to lose. Sometimes in our lives, we're trying so hard to control what we have. There's this famous quote that says, "He is no fool who gives up what he cannot gain to keep what he cannot lose." Every time somebody goes down into the baptismal pool at North San Jose and I watch it happen, I think to myself, I would so much rather have sacrificed for that than have a 2014 Jeep than a 2004 and have a couple extra doors on my Jeep, 4-2. See, the inconvenience of the sacrifice is trumped by the reward of obedience to Jesus when you give up control in your life. So some of us, we have things, but we don't just have things. Things have us. They control us, our time, our talent, our money. And so we never discover our purpose because we're trying so hard to protect what's ours. When Jesus is saying, if you'll give up control, there's so much more that you could see if you will relinquish what's in your hands and put it in my hands. How far will it go among so many? It depends. It really does depend. Is it in your hands or is it in the hands of Jesus? So now Jesus takes the loaves, and it says he took the loaves, he gave thanks. Why is he giving thanks? Isn't that kind of weird? You don't have enough food for all these people. Why are you thanking the Heavenly Father now? See, oftentimes miracles are met with gratitude. It's thanking God before you have the solution that he's been faithful and he's going to provide the solution. It's trusting in the Heavenly Father before what seems like division becomes multiplication. So he takes the loaves of bread and he starts to multiply. I just imagine what that must have been like, just if you could get like a close up on it. You know, if we could have a YouTube video of it. And it's boom, boom, it's like a bread. Boom, 2, 4, 2, 8, 2, 16, 2, 32, 2, 64, 2, 128, 2, 516. I mean, it's just what it'd be so awesome. So Jesus starts doing it, and it says, then it was distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted, and he did the exact same thing with the fish. So he's boom, 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 it's just going on and on. And it says, when they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, gather all the pieces that are left over and let nothing be wasted. Leftovers. How many of you guys like leftovers? I love, love, love leftovers. And here's this leftover. It just starts going. And then finally, when it's done, it says, so they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the five. That math doesn't make sense, does it? Five barley loaves, 12. Anyways, so they had some leftovers, and it said that these were left over by those who had already eaten. So now I'm visualizing another conversation. And this is the conversation that if the little boy got an extra lunch basket to go home with. Because, you know, in our family, a lot of times our kids come home with their lunch and they haven't eaten it. That conversation is kind of funny. What happened? Oh, my friend had a lunch and he gave me the, yeah, right, your friend had a lunch. You just didn't eat it. You didn't want the food that I made. You didn't want the turkey. You didn't want the vegetables. Why are there vegetables there? Well, because my friend gave me vegetables. No, your friend didn't give you vegetables. You didn't eat the vegetables. And here's this little boy who comes home with his fish and his loaves of bread, and he's got leftovers. When you trust God, you have leftovers. It's not always financial. It's oftentimes spiritual. It's the resources for your life to be a blessing to the lives of people around you. So some of us, it feels like we have nothing left to give, but we haven't given up control. And the third thing is that we haven't trusted Jesus with the outcome of our lives. See, in order to live into your purpose, you have to understand that there is a death between when you give up control and when he uses your life. It's hard. It's not easy. Scripture says that God loves a cheerful giver, a hilarious giver. It's almost like when you trust God, you're like, I don't know how it's going to work out, but I'm going to trust him. And when we trust him with the outcomes, he's able to provide leftovers for every single physical need that we have, every spiritual need. See, some of us are in that gap today, and we're standing outside of our purpose. And God is inviting us into both our individual and collective purpose as a church. There are some folks, and we're so glad you're here, and you've been coming for like 8 years, but you haven't gotten involved yet, and you love the church, and you love the family ministry, but you haven't actually given up control of your life to Jesus. You know, the reality is the longer you come without giving up, I'm talking to followers of Jesus right now, okay? The longer you come and you still hold on, the less we can do for you as a church. It's kind of like just keep coming and keep coming and keep getting fed, but never trusting God with what's in our hands. There's so much more that God has for you if you would trust him with the outcome of your life. So it's seeing opportunity when there's a gap. It's putting what's in our hands into his hands and giving up control. And then ultimately, it's trusting him with the outcomes of our lives. That's how our purpose is discovered and how we live into it. Not just know it, but we live it. And he's making an invitation to you today to step into it. Now, I'd like to talk about how that relates to what we're doing as a church, because we're wrestling through that question. But we've been wrestling through some questions specifically for the last 8 years since we've been going as a church. And I want to share some of these with you. Just don't feel the weight of it. Let it become an opportunity for you to see what God's doing, okay? First question that we started our church asking was, what if we could be a part of changing the spiritual landscape of the Bay Area? I'm not sure if you know this, but the Bay Area is the most unchurched area in all of the United States, percentage-wise. Might be surprising to some of you. If you go to the Southeast, you drive around, there's a street, there's a church on every street corner. You come to the Bay Area, you could drive 4 days and not see a church building. And we said from the very beginning, what if that could be different? What if one day the San Francisco Bay Area could be known for a movement of the message of Jesus? And it doesn't matter what church or what leader gets the credit for it, but what if we could see a movement, revival in our area that changes the spiritual landscape of this area? That was our prayer from the beginning. And it was way beyond any of us or our power or our talent. I was 27 when we started the church, and I had no clue, just like now, I had no clue what I was doing, but we just had this vision. We said, God, use us. We need you. We're dependent upon you. This opportunity zone, it's yours for the miraculous. So we started in February of 2009, and the church grew, and we started more services. We went 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 in Don Calajon Elementary in Santa Clara, and it just kept growing. And we said, eventually, there's going to need to be a building for all this. We're running out of space. So we asked our leaders and our people to give sacrificially. We called it the Forward Initiative. And in November of 2010, our people came up with gifts, one-time gifts and commitments over the next 3 years so that we can move into the North San Jose campus. And when we did that, our number of people that followed Jesus over the next several years increased by 70% when we took that step of faith. God opened up a massive door for our church. We grew. We almost doubled in size. We multiplied, and God started growing our church. But then we said, you know, this is not enough. There's more that God wants to do. It's not one location. It's not a building. So then we started asking, what if we could see a church or campus started within 15 minutes of every person in the Bay Area? Isn't that awesome to think about? So like you got a friend in San Ramon, or you have somebody that you know in San Bruno or Sausalito. Do people live in Sausalito? In Sausalito. And you have all these people that you know all over the Bay Area, and you're building friendships with them, but they got to drive across the Bay to get to a church. What if there could be a life-giving church where the message of Jesus was proclaimed and lost people who are far from God were welcomed within 15 minutes of every person in the Bay Area? Just unbelievable to think of the potential. I remember coming here and just going around asking, do you know of a church where people are welcomed and accepted? And person after person, I'd go to coffee shop. No, I don't know. But God's changing it. And we started saying, okay, let's start a campus in Sunnyvale. We got a lot of people coming there. So that campus, we started in February of 2014. That grew. Then we said, okay, let's move to South San Jose. In February of 2016, we started that. You can see from this map some of the examples of places where we've been able to touch. We moved into San Jose to help start Garden City Church and Center Point Church, and you can see all the way up into the city with Epic Church and the Movement Church in Oakland. And now we have several campuses or churches that we're looking to help start up in San Ramon. We're going to help start a church up there called Journey East Bay Eden Church over in Mountain View or Campbell, and then Current Church over in Mountain View. And so we're starting to see this movement become more and more prevalent as the message of Jesus is spreading, and there's churches and there's campuses. And finally, we're asking the question now, what if? Sometimes what if is the most powerful question to ask. What if we could be a part of a movement that reaches 100,000 people as a church? Far beyond any of our leadership or ability or capacity. But a movement of 100,000 people doesn't matter if one doesn't matter to us. So watch this story of one life that has been changed by South Bay Church.
Hi, my name is Tasha Radford, and this is my story. I've been attending Sunnyvale South Bay campus for about 2 years. And it was about 5 years ago to the day that I was invited to my first life group. I started going to this life group on Friday nights, and Don and Kent Lietzau just made it so comfortable. Don and Kent invited me to the celebration service at South Bay. God moved that day through Pastor Andy. I listened to every word that he was saying, and I could just feel my heart soften. Nothing could keep me in my seat. It was at that moment that I surrendered. I was so tired of trying to be strong in my own strength. And that day I stood up and I got baptized that day. I was so tired of feeling anxious, but when I went down in that baptism pool and came up, I was healed. All the anxiety was gone. My mentor Dawn never let me go. She taught me how to pray. She taught me how to journal. She included me in her Bible studies. She poured into me. She was my accountability partner. Dawn really got to know me well, and she knew what my gifts were. She told me I had the gift of encouragement, and she told me to go forward and lead a life group. I was leading Breaking Free in the summer on the back porch with a group of women, and I found my community. I have family right in Sunnyvale, right in the heart of the Silicon Valley. I don't have to go 5 minutes to find a best friend that I can call on any time of the day. Sunnyvale campus is a special place. My son had a chronic sickness, and I believe in prayer, and I've seen God answer prayer, and I had Felipe lay hands on my son, and my son was healed. Sunnyvale campus has helped my family grow in faith, not only in my leading studies, but my oldest son, Colby, is now serving in the children's ministry there. And my two younger children, both Mason and Jossie, have given their lives to Christ. And I am so thankful for South Bay Kids and the leaders there who have poured into my children who are so faith-filled. I am so thankful for Sunnyvale South Bay Campus. I think of Bay Kids and all of the leaders there that have poured into my children and how my children are now following Jesus. I love the First Impressions team, how they greet you when you come in, and it's such a warm place to be when you come to South Bay Sunnyvale campus. And the prayer team, they've prayed for me so many times. And if God is doing that on a portable campus, I can't wait to see what God is going to do in a permanent building where we can meet throughout the week, where children can meet throughout the week. The possibilities are going to be endless for God. This is just the beginning of what God is going to do in the hearts of people in the Sunnyvale community. This isn't just our city. This is God's city, and He is working here. Imagine what God can do in Sunnyvale.
Let's give it up for the power of people's lives being changed with the message of Jesus. And the question is, how is it going to happen? How are we actually going to go about this? The first thing is that we're going to increase our local and global compassion efforts as a church. One of the biggest initiatives for us right now is what we're doing with Foster the Bay. Foster the Bay is a ministry that we helped start with several other churches that the vision is to reverse the problem of fostering in our area, meaning that there are kids waiting for families to open their homes to them in the foster care system. That means that if they don't get a family, by the time they turn 18, the majority of them will end up in a lifestyle apart from the grace of God. Many of them will become prostitutes. They'll be sold into slavery. And we as a church family can change that. And our hope is that one day there will be families waiting for children. That as soon as they come into the foster care system, there's a family from our church or a family that follows Jesus that can welcome them with love. So we're going to increase what we do there. Secondly, we're going to plant more churches. I'm relying on the prompter now. Secondly, we're going to, number two, we're going to plant more churches in our area. We're going to start a church in Mountain View. We're going to start a church in Campbell. And we're going to start a church up in San Ramon because we believe it's more than just about our church. It's more than just about a building. It's about that bigger vision of seeing the entire Bay Area transform with the message of Jesus. And then thirdly, we're going to get our campuses into larger, more permanent facilities. That's the third thing. We're going to get our church, our campuses into larger, more permanent facilities. So Santa Teresa High School is a move that moves South San Jose into a bigger rented space, but part of next is going to be that we're going to save up some money to move them into a building when God opens up the door. And then many of you already know this, but a huge chunk of what we're doing with Next is going towards the Sunnyvale building that God has already opened the door on September 28th. We closed on that building, and now we're in the process of making decisions to renovate it. Here's what it can look like. Let's look at some pictures together. This is driving up 1145 East Arquez from the street. As you pull in, that's you in Sunnyvale pulling in. This is the front entrance walking into the building. When you get in, you can see this lobby that is just warm and welcoming to every person that comes in. It looks consistent with our other campuses. And then in addition to this, you can see from the other angle, imagine that building just filled with people far from God and their lives being changed by Him. And we're making decisions right now, folks. This is a huge, huge project for us. This is a gap. That's our opportunity zone between what we have and what we need. And here's what we need as a church. We need to raise $1 million in one-time gifts between now and the end of the year. The good news is our leaders and our key givers, many of our faithful givers, have already given $500,000 of that. So we can praise God. There are stories of people that delayed vacations, that stopped projects and renovations on their house. There are single moms that gave hundreds of dollars and tens of dollars. And then there are some people that gave tens of thousands of dollars. And people are sacrificing for this vision. And we're in this place where that money is going to help us renovate the building. We're making decisions. Do we do this light fixture or this light fixture? And we're going to discover whether or not we are in together next week at our commitment week. So we're going to give a one-time gift. And here's also what I want to ask you. I want to ask you to make a one-time contribution next weekend at commitment weekend, and then next weekend to let us know what you can do above and beyond your regular giving over the next 3 years. And our goal for that is $2 million. So that total goal for our church is a $3 million goal that we're trying to raise that will help offset the building payments, that will increase our capacity with what we do with Foster the Bay, that will help us start new churches, and it's a God-size vision. It's bigger than what we can do with our own power, with our own strength, with our own resources. And here's what I want to ask of you. I'm not asking you to be the miracle, okay, to solve that big problem. I'm asking you to take what's in your hands and put it into the hands of Jesus. You are a tool. Your life has a purpose. And some of us, we're inside the toolbox and we haven't started trusting God. So next week, you're going to get an envelope in the mail. And on Sunday, November 13th, I want to ask you to come back ready to make a one-time gift and a commitment above and beyond the next 3 years. And let's see God do the miraculous through our lives. The question is, what can God do with what you have? Some of us write ourselves off because we feel like we don't have much to give. But the reality is, how far can one loaf of bread go? It depends on whose hands it's in. And the question is our lives and our church in the hands of the master? The tool finds its purpose in the hands of the master. The bread finds its fulfillment in its ability to provide when it gets into the hands of Jesus. And the question is, are we together going to trust God for the miraculous? I'm asking you to make a legacy move, guys, to give of yourself for something that's far greater than the things of this world. When you stand before God, what's going to count is whether or not you invested your life in things that were eternal. And some of us, it's not about money, guys. It's not about an amount of money. It's about the condition of our hearts. God wants to show you. He wants to redirect you that there's so much more that he has for your life. And the things of this world, when they don't have a hold of you anymore and they're in the hands of Jesus, there's no limit to what God can do through your life and through what God can do through us together. And the question is, will South Bay Church trust the hands of the one who's been faithful, who spoke the world into existence, the one who made the stars and the sky, is able to do exceedingly and abundantly beyond anything that we could ask or imagine? I want to invite you to stand with me. Father, we're grateful that you're the God who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly beyond all that we could ask, think, or imagine. We're grateful for the power of your word that spoke the world into existence and the power that you have to take our lives and use us for your glory. Would you multiply what's in our hands? Would you start and finish this movement that the whole Bay Area would know your love? It's not enough just to see it happen for 8 years. We're in this for the long haul, Jesus. There's no vision that I believe in more than what you're doing right here. And I want to trust you, God, to do what it is that only you can do. In Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen.